Monday to everybody. I hope everybody's having a beautiful and blessed Monday, ready for an amazing week. This song is actually, you know what, I figured all of the lights, because week 18 has come and all of the lights were on. A lot of teams, you know, compete for their playoff lives. A lot of teams competing for something more postseason. And you know, we got some amazing football games. So let's go ahead and hop into it. This is The Breakdown, X's and O's with Nate Ness. I'm your host, Nate Ness. And I had to rep my alma mater today, Arizona, the University of Arizona, where it all began. So appreciative for the opportunity to attend the University of Arizona and compete there. But you know, it makes you appreciate a lot of things. Black Monday. This is the Monday that is really, really, really a hard time. Just like cut day is, because some coaches are going to be relieved of their duties. Now, it really hit me, because the coaches are no different than the players. So I wanted to, you know what, extend just love and support to all of the coaches, all of the personnel that are being relieved of their duties. Thank you for your hard work. I know it's not easy. This is a high performance business, but thank you for your efforts and thank you for all that it is that you do. Thank you for your families for always, you know what, sticking by and supporting the team, you, the players, everything. So, man, I'm just giving my love out to all the coaches and the GMs, the executives that may be relieved of their duties on this Black Monday. So, let's go ahead and hop right into it. Week 18, the closing of the season. Man, we had some great games. I'm going to kick off this one. At Ford Field, we have the NFC North matchup between the Green Bay Packers, who gained the number one overall seed in the NFC playoffs and home field throughout the playoffs last week. They're traveling to take on the Detroit Lions. Now, the Packers, they have the first round bye, you know, and you know what? They started Rodgers at quarterback just to go ahead and keep him in rhythm, keep him in flow. And Aaron was efficient. He was sharp, going 14 for 18 for 138 yards, two touchdowns, no interception before being pulled for Jordan Love. Now, Jordan Love came in, he finished the second half. Love struggled, to be completely honest with you. He struggled, going 10 of 17 for 134 yards, one touchdown, two interceptions. A.J. Dillon led the Packers on the ground with 14 carries for 63 yards, and Patrick Taylor chipped in 53 yards on 11 carries and one rushing touchdown. Alan Lazard, he was the playmaker for the Packers offense, as he had five receptions for 75 yards and two touchdowns. Josiah DeGuara chipped in three receptions for 66 yards and a touchdown. Now, the Lions on the other side, we know my Lions have had a rough season. Yet, they come out week in and week out and compete, and they show pride. And Sunday was no different. Now, Jared Goff showed up in a big way, going 21 for 30 for 238 yards, two touchdowns. He definitely led this Lions team. DeAndre Swift led the Lions on the ground with seven carries for 30 yards and one touchdown. And the Lions had two receivers go over 100 yards, leading with Ross St. Brown leading the way with eight receptions for 109 yards and a touchdown. And Khalif Raymond, four receptions for 101 yards and a touchdown. Brock Wright also got into the mix with two receptions for 51 yards and another touchdown. And the Lions, I mean, they may have had a season full of, like, you know, struggles and they struggles and lows and hardships. Yet, they end the season on a high note, beating the Packers 37-30. Congratulations, Lions. All right, this game right here, this game pissed me off. And pissed me off in the sense of, you know, again, as I've stated before in my other breakdowns, teams are competing for, you know what, just your playoff lives. And you don't have the opportunity, you don't have the room to come out and come out flat and lay an egg. And this is just what happened. So we're going to go ahead and go to TIA Bank Field for this AFC South matchup as Indianapolis Colts visit the Jacksonville Jaguars. And man, this game right here was a clear definition of a missed opportunity. A missed opportunity and sloppy play. The Colts were horrible on the day. There's no way to just, you know what, sugarcoat it. They were horrible on the day. You know what? In a day in which you controlled your own destiny, your playoff destiny, and you come out and lay an egg. Carson Wentz, completely horrible. Going 17 for 29 for 185 yards, one touchdown, one interception. Jonathan Taylor was held pretty much in check the whole day, going for 77 yards on 15 carries. Michael Pittman led the Colts with six receptions for 64 yards and one touchdown. But the Jaguars, they probably, in my opinion, they played their best game of the year. Trevor Lawrence looked every bit of the number one overall draft pick as he finished the game 23 for 32 for 223 yards and two touchdowns. Rykel Armstead led the Jags on the ground with nine carries for 52 yards. And Marvin Jones had a great game, a good day in my opinion, for the receiver as he had 7 receptions for 88 yards, 1 touchdown. And Laquon Treadwell put in 3 receptions for 24 yards and another touchdown. And the Jaguars, they took care of business. The Colts, they came into this game underestimating this Jaguars team because of their record and how they had all these struggles throughout the whole year. But the Jags, they came out firing, came out swinging, not caring who they were playing against. We wanted to end the season on the right note, and they did, on a positive note, eliminating the Colts from playoff contention 26-11. Congratulations, Jags. All right, now we're going to head to MetLife Stadium for this NFC East division battle. Now between the New York Giants and they hosting the Washington football team. And a game of two teams who have struggled all year. The Washington football team didn't play their best game yet. They shut the Giants out for 3 quarters and played pretty well. They missed a few opportunities, you know, here and there. Taylor Heineke was really off as he went 9 of 18 for 120 yards. But Antonio Gibson was the clear star of the day as he rushed for 146 yards on 21 carries and a touchdown. Terry McLaurin had an okay, a decent day, going 4 receptions for 93 yards. But on the other side, you know what, the Giants, again, this has just been a horrible season for them. You know what, they got Jake Fromm under center, and he didn't do nothing, he didn't do anything amazing, going 15 for 31 for 103 yards, 1 touchdown, 2 interceptions. Fromm also led the team in rushing, going for 53 yards on 5 carries. Darius Slayton, this type of game it was a rough game for the Giants. Darius Slayton was the Giants' leading receiver, and he had 2 receptions for 29 yards, but he did also have a receiving touchdown. The Washington football team, they end the season on a positive note, but the Giants have a lot of work they got to go. Both teams have a lot of work to do, but the Giants have a lot of work that they got to figure it out. But Washington, congratulations on a 22-7 victory. All right, to U.S. Bank Stadium, the Minnesota Vikings host NFC division rivals, the Chicago Bears. Now, the Bears started the game off fast, leading 14-3 at halftime. But as I've said before many times, you can't start out fast and not finish strong. Andy Dalton was decent on the day. He made some mistakes, missed some reads here and there, finishing the game 33-48 for 325 yards, 1 touchdown, 2 interceptions. David Montgomery led the Bears on the ground with 72 yards on 20 carries, and Darnell Mooney, he had a big game, 12 receptions for 126 yards, and Damian Williams chipped in 3 receptions for 33 yards on a touchdown. The Vikings, I don't know where to start with them. It's been a heartbreaking season for them. Losing close games, injuries, and just bad breaks. But, they put it all together this game. Kirk Cousins, he had a solid game, going 14 for 22 for 250 yards, 3 touchdowns, no interceptions. Dalvin Cook had a decent game, going for 79 yards on 14 carries. And the Vikings also produced 2 receivers who went over 100 yards on the day, with Justin Jefferson leading the way with 5 receptions for 107 yards, 1 touchdown. And Amir Smith-Marset chipped in 3 receptions for 103 yards and a touchdown. KJ Osborne also had a receiving touchdown on the day, and the Vikings end the season on a positive note, defeating their division opponent 31-17. All right, now we're going to head over to NRG Stadium as the Houston Texans host their AFC rivals, the Tennessee Titans. Now, as you can see, Week 18 is all about division games, and I love how the NFL, did it this season. The Titans, they have an opportunity to get home field throughout the whole AFC playoffs. And, they started off slow. The Titans, they came out slow, but they got it going and didn't let the moment slip past them. Ryan Tannehill, in my opinion, he saved his best performance for the final game of the season, and he played a great game, going 23 for 32 for 287 yards, 4 touchdowns, no interceptions. He was big. There was no other way to tell it. I'm not going to even, sugarcoat it or nothing, BS y'all. He was just big, and he showed up when the team needed and it mattered. Deontay Foreman led the Titans on the ground with 21 carries for 69 yards. And the Titans had multiple receivers step up and produce in the game, with Nick Westbrook leading the way with 4 receptions for 78 yards and a touchdown. A.J. Brown had 4 for 68 in a touchdown. Julio Jones chipped in 5 receptions for 58 yards and 1 touchdown. And Anthony Firkser chipped in 4 for 56 and another touchdown. So many players contributed on the day, and that's a really great sign for Coach Vrabel and this Tennessee team. Just an amazing sign. The Texans, they started off slow. They started off slow, and they were down 21-0 going into halftime, yet they came out, and they came out and played. Tennessee kind of took their foot off the gas, and Davis Mills, and that Davis Mills, he had a solid outing, and that team started coming back. He went 23 for 33 for 301 yards, 3 touchdowns, no interceptions. Now, the Texans really didn't have a rushing attack, So, I mean, I'm not going to even speak on that. But Danny Amendola did lead the Texans with 7 receptions for 113 yards and 2 touchdowns. And Chris Moore also had a receiving touchdown on the day. And the Texans, they battled and battled and they battled hard. But Tennessee did everything they needed to do to get this win and to secure the number one seed in the AFC playoffs 28-25. Guys, excuse me. All right. Now, we're going to head to M&T Bank Stadiums. Now, I know I talked about the Philadelphia-Dallas rivalry. Now, we're going to talk about one of the best and oldest, another old and best rivalry in the game. Baltimore Ravens hosting the Pittsburgh Steelers. There's so much history between these teams when it comes to classic competitive defensive games. Big Ben Roethlisberger, and possibly his final game as a pro, had a solid day. And you know what? A great day for Ben, going 30-44, 244 yards, one touchdown, one interception. Chase Claypool, he led the Steelers in rushing with three carries for 33 yards. And Pat Freiermuth led the Steelers with 6 receptions for 53 yards. And Chase Claypool chipped in 5 for 37 yards and a touchdown. But on the other side, the Ravens, as bad as the Ravens played, they played really pretty bad. They still had an opportunity to win the game. Tyler Huntley had a rough day, going 16 for 31 for 141 yards, 2 interceptions. Now, Latavius Murray, he had himself a monster game. He had himself a great day on the ground, producing 150 yards on 16 carries and 1 touchdown. Great day for Latavius Murray. He really looked really good, and he was punishing the Steelers' defense. Mark Andrews, Pro Bowler, had another solid day, going for 85 yards on 8 receptions. But in a defensive game, the Steelers made more plays, getting 2 interceptions and 3 sacks on defense, with T.J. Watt tying Michael Strahan's all-time single-season sack record with 22.5. Congratulations to the Steelers. They won, and they make the playoffs on a 16-13 victory over the Ravens. All right. To First Energy Stadium, as AFC North champion, Cincinnati Bengals travel to take on the Cleveland Browns. Now, the Bengals rested most of the starters. So, Brandon Allen started in place of Jake Burrow. And the 5-year pro from Arkansas, he had a quiet day, going 15 for 29 for 136 yards, 1 touchdown, no interceptions. I mean, again, quiet day, but again, he wasn't asked to do much. You just go in there, play the game, do what you got to do. Travion Williams led the Bengals on the ground with 9 carries for 38 yards. And Jamar Chase chipped in 2 receptions for 26 yards. And with that, those 2 receptions and those 26 yards, he surpassed Chad Johnson for the Bengals' single-season record reception yards with 1,455 on them. So congratulations to Jamar Chase. A hell of a rookie season for you, man. But keep going. Keep getting better, young man. Keep getting better. On the other side, Case Keenum, he started in place of Baker Mayfield, who they shut down so he can get shoulder surgery. So Case Keenum came in. He had a solid day, going 17 for 24 for 176 yards, 2 touchdowns, 1 interception. Now, when we talk about the Browns, we always talk about the running game. And when you associate the Browns' running game, the dominating running game, you think of Nick Chubb. Well, Nick Chubb was solid on the day, going for 58 yards on 9 carries. But it was D'Ernest Johnson who had the game, leading the Browns with 25 carries for 123 yards and 1 touchdown. He ran with power and just looked great on the day. Jarvis Landry led the Browns with 6 receptions for 75 yards and 1 touchdown. And Demetric Felton chipped in another receiving touchdown. And even though the Bengals rested their starters, they played the game really, really close. Can't take anything away from they played the game close. But the Browns take this game and end the season on a positive note, 21-16. All right. This game right here frustrated me too. This game frustrated me. So we're going to head to LA for SoFi Stadium for this clash between the NFC West rivals, the San Francisco 49ers versus Los Angeles Rams. Now, this was a really good game. And it was a classic start fast. And the fire burns out as the 49ers team, they battle. They're battling for their playoff lives. And it's simple. With them as far as winning, you know, and improving seeding. And the same goes for the Rams. Jimmy G, in my opinion, he had a subpar game. Yet it's something about when 49ers play the Rams. Like the 49ers have the Rams' number or something. Jimmy finished the day 23 for 32 for 316 yards, 1 touchdown, 2 interceptions. Made a couple of misreads on a couple of those throws. You know, again, Deebo Samuel, though, I don't know. I know it's early, but this guy is a once-in-a-generation type of talent, like with a production, and he had a big game. You know, he threw for a 24-yard touchdown. He rushed 45 yards on 8 carries and had another touchdown, and also had 4 receptions for 95 yards. I mean, great production from the third-year pro from South Carolina. Eli Mitchell led the Niners on the ground with 21 carries for 85 yards. And Brandon Ayuk, he had a great day for the 49ers, leading them with 6 receptions for 107 yards. And Juwan Jennings chipped in 6 receptions for 94 yards and 2 touchdowns. The Rams, on the other hand, I mean, they started off fast. So when they went up 17-3 at half, you know, I'm thinking, okay, man, it's going to be a great game. Like, you know, the Rams are going to lock up that number 2 spot. You know, they look to focus. But they couldn't keep the fire going into the second half. And Matthew Stafford, oh, Matt, come on. What are you thinking? Some of these throws you're making, man, you got to, come on. We got to be focused. You know, he wasn't good on the day. And the Rams needed him to be. Finishing the day 21 for 32 for 238 yards, 3 touchdowns and 2 interceptions. It's the interceptions. Like, you know, it's not helping the team. Now, the Rams couldn't establish no running game. So, as Sonny Michel was held to 43 yards on 21 carries. Cooper Kupp, he had another solid game with 7 receptions for 118 yards, 1 touchdown, and he got the triple crown. And Tyler Higbee chipped in 6 receptions for 55 yards and 2 touchdowns. But again, this game, it was about the Rams and them not finishing. Now, the 49ers, they rolled a strong defense that recorded 5 sacks and 2 interceptions to steal this game from the Rams and improve their playoff season 27-24. But the Rams did still win the NFC West.
All right.
Next stop, we're going to Raymond James Stadium as the defending champion Tampa Bay Buccaneers host NFC rivals the Carolina Panthers. And this game was really a tune-up, and honestly, for the Bucs, because the Panthers aren't in a place to compete with them, honestly. Now, Sam Darnold had a quiet day for the Panthers, going 29 for 42 for 219 yards, 2 touchdowns, 1 interception. Chuba Hubbard led the Panthers on the ground with 9 carries for 48 yards, and DJ Moore led the Panthers in receiving with 7 receptions for 87 yards. And Robbie Anderson and Chuba Hubbard both had receiving touchdowns on the day. Now, the Bucs played a great game, and they really erupted in the fourth quarter, you know, a big time to put the game away. Tom Brady, you know, just really getting ready for postseason, had a great game, going 29-37 for 326 yards, 3 touchdowns, no interceptions. Now, the offense is just really playing at a high level. You know, again, Scotty Miller led the Bucs in rushing with 2 carries for 43 yards and a touchdown. And Keyshawn Vaughn chipped in 10 carries for 29 yards and another rushing touchdown. Rob Gronkowski had himself a monster game. I mean, I see you, Rob. I see you, baby. And you know what? The Bucs just, again, looked great. He led them with 7 receptions for 137 yards. And Mike Evans chipped in 6 receptions for 89 yards and 2 touchdowns. And with that, Mike Evans completed his 8th consecutive 1,000-yard season. And the Bucs, with this win, are now locked into the number 2 spot in the NFC playoffs, 41-17. All right. Now we're going to hit the State Farm Stadium for the NFC West matchup between the Arizona Cardinals hosting the Seattle Seahawks. And this game was a great back-and-forth game. Russell Wilson had a solid game, going 15 for 26 for 238 yards, 3 touchdowns, 1 interception. But he also chipped in a rushing touchdown, too, on the ground. Rashad Penny, another big week. Now, he's going to make the Seahawks front office think about re-signing him to a long-term deal, because he's had, the last month and a half, he's had amazing monster weeks. And he had a career day, rushing for 190 yards on 23 carries and 1 touchdown. Tyler Lockett led the Seahawks in receiving with 5 receptions for 98 yards and 2 touchdowns. And Freddie Swain also had a receiving touchdown today. Now, we just not to take anything away from the Cardinals, because the Cardinals actually played a decent game. And, I mean, it was great competition from both teams. Kyler Murray had a decent game, going 28-39 for 240 yards, 1 touchdown, no interceptions. James Conner, he had some great production on the ground, leading the team with 15 carries for 52 yards and a touchdown, and 6 receptions for 41 yards and another receiving touchdown. Just great production. Zach Ertz had a nice game, as he led them in receiving with 7 receptions for 84 yards. But this game was a classic back-and-forth affair, but the Seahawks end this tough season on a positive note, defeating their division rivals 38-30. Oh, man, now we're going to head to my old stomping grounds. Yes, South Florida, to the Hard Rock Stadium for this AFC East matchup between the New England Patriots visiting Miami Dolphins. And this was a good game. The Patriots started the game off slow, but they battled their way back. Mac Jones was decent on the day, going 20 for 30 for 261 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 interception. He made really one mistake on the day, and that mistake really proved to be costly. Brandon Bolden had a productive day leading the Patriots on the ground with 7 carries for 46 yards and 1 touchdown. And he also had 2 receptions for 20 yards and another touchdown receiving. Damian Harris chipped in 11 carries for 37 yards and a touchdown. Now, Hunter Henry was the leading receiver for the Patriots, as he had 5 receptions for 86 yards. But the Dolphins, on the other hand, man, I mean, it wasn't a pretty game, yet they did all they needed to do to win. Now, Tua wasn't really much of a factor, going 15 for 22 for 109 yards and one touchdown. But it was really about Duke Johnson and the running game, as he had a solid game, rushing for 117 yards on 25 carries and one touchdown. Jaylen Waddle had 5 receptions for 27 yards and a touchdown, bringing his rookie total to 104. And with those receptions, he broke the NFL single-season record for rookies that was held by Anquan Boldin with 101 in 2003. And the Dolphins, who played a really solid game, they sweep the Patriots for the first time since 2000 with this 33-24 victory.
All right.
To Mercedes-Benz Stadium.
Oh, man.
Now, that's our next destination for the Falcons to host this NFC South matchup with the New Orleans Saints. Now, the Saints came in and they played it because they actually had a chance to make it to the NFC playoffs as the final wild card spot. And the playoffs is at hand again, so you know, you're not going to miss this opportunity. And they were firing on all cylinders as they led the Falcons 24-6. Taysom Hill had a solid game before he left with a foot injury, and before leaving the game, he was 7-9 for 107 yards and one touchdown. So in came Trevor Siemian in relief duty, and he did very well, going 9 for 15 for 71 yards and two touchdowns. Now, I know the passing yards weren't really big, you know, but he did make some very impressive throws. Alvin Kamara, he had a huge day for the Saints as he rushed for 146 yards on 30 carries. Traquan Smith had a solid game leading the Saints with 5 receptions for 76 yards, one touchdown. And Adam Trautman and Juwan Johnson, they both had receiving touchdowns on the day for the Saints. The Falcons, though, started off slow and couldn't really, like, you know, get going. Matt Ryan was subpar on the day, going 20 for 33 for 216 yards, one touchdown, and one interception. Quadri Allison had a rushing touchdown for the Falcons, and Russell Gage had another solid day as he led the Falcons with 9 receptions for 126 yards and one touchdown. But with that touchdown, Matt Ryan moved up into ninth all-time on the passing touchdown list, passing Eli Manning. But again, the Falcons couldn't make up for the 3 turnovers they committed on offense, and the Saints win a big game, 30-20.
All right.
To Highmark Stadium, that's our next stop. Another AFC East matchup. Buffalo Bills host AFC East rivals the New York Jets. And this is a game about the Bills getting on track before the playoffs. Now, the Jets, they really struggled out the gate. Zach Wilson was pretty much non-existent, and he was a non-factor as he went 7 for 20 for 87 yards, one touchdown. And he also led the Jets in rushing with 2 carries for 24 yards. Keelan Cole led the Jets with 3 receptions for 54 yards. But again, this is not about the Jets and their inability. They're a team that's still in a rebuild. They're trying to find their identity. This is about the Buffalo Bills. And the Buffalo Bills were all focused, and they were business. Josh Allen had a decent day, going 24 for 45 for 239 yards, 2 touchdowns, no interception. And he also chipped in 5 carries for 63 yards. Devin Singletary, he had a productive day. And I just really liked the way how he was running the ball. Now, I know it's the Jets, but still, he was nice, going for 88 yards on 19 carries and a touchdown. And also having 2 receptions for 24 yards and a receiving touchdown. So that's great production for them. Stephon Diggs had a great day leading the Bills with 9 receptions for 81 yards and one touchdown. And the Bills defense really harassed the Jets as they record 9 sacks and cruise to their 11th victory in their second division title, 27-10.
All right.
The best game I've seen in a long time. And I'm not just saying that. This is the closeout game for Week 18. AFC West matchup between the Las Vegas Raiders hosting the LA Chargers. And this is a simple game for both teams. Win and you're in. And what can I say? With that much riding on the season and on this game, both teams came out and they competed. This was such a competitive game. The Chargers, they came out slow in the first, but they got going in the second quarter, scoring 2 touchdowns and trailing 17-14 at half. Justin Herbert had an amazing game. He completed 34 of 68 passes. And I mean, for 383 yards, 3 touchdowns, 1 interception. And that game was so amazing. I mean, to be honest, I feel that Justin Herbert solidified himself and that he's going to be one of the top quarterbacks in this league. And the Chargers they just have to continue to build around this guy. He can be special. He can actually take this team and get them over that hump. But you got to build around him. Austin Eckler has another solid day of production, rushing 64 yards on 16 carries and one touchdown, and 5 receptions for 35 yards and another receiving touchdown. Mike Williams led the Chargers with 8 receptions for 119 yards and one touchdown, and Josh Palmer chipped in 4 receptions for 45 yards and another touchdown. But the Raiders, man, the Raiders on the other side, I mean, this game and this game for the season, and they didn't let the moment fly past them. You know what, Derek Carr had a decent game, but he really didn't have to do much, going 20 for 36 for 186 yards, 2 touchdowns, no interceptions. Now, Josh Jacobs, he was the bell cow. He had a monster game and a huge game, and he really controlled the pace of the game, rushing for 132 yards on 26 carries and one touchdown. Brian Edwards led the team in receiving with 4 receptions for 63 yards, and Hunter Renfrow had 2 receiving touchdowns on the day. Now, the Chargers, they battled. I mean, they battled, scoring 15 points in the fourth quarter to send the game into overtime. And in that fourth quarter, Justin Herbert, he made some throws that just left me in amazement, forcing this game into an extra quarter. But it was the Raiders that came out on top after a 47-yard Daniel Carlson field goal, which was the second field goal of the extra, you know, of the overtime period, to win this game 35-32 and claw their way into the playoffs. Great game. That was a great competitive game. All right. My final thoughts. An amazing, blissful season. A competitive season. You know, it had its highs and its lows. But I'm not just talking about being a former player, but as a fan, I was just in amazement at the way these guys went out there competing week in and week out. I mean, it's a high performance business. It's hard to win in the NFL. And you got to continue to apply yourself week in and week out. You can't allow yourself to get comfortable and allow yourself to just really just we did good this week, because each week is different. You gotta always apply yourself. But now we're going into the postseason. Regular season is cool. I'm not taking anything away from the regular season. But legends are made in the postseason. So who's gonna be the legend, or who's gonna make their, like, you know, who's gonna just really immortalize themselves in this postseason? 14 teams are competing for a Super Bowl. 14 teams are competing to make it to the Super Bowl. So who's going to make the necessary plays? Who's going to position themselves and not allow themselves to, like, really get comfortable? You know, again, each game is important. Each play is important. It's when you win or go home. That's the reality of it. So continue to get better, fellas. Continue to apply yourself. And let's go. The playoffs are here. So thank you guys for tuning in. Thank you guys for just hanging out with me and supporting me all season long. I am so humbled. I am so blessed. It is by God's grace that I'm doing something that I love and that I'm passionate about, and that you guys have supported me, giving me feedback, liking my content. Thank you. I'm pushing to get myself into ESPN or CBS Sports or something. But thank you guys from the bottom of my heart for all of your support along this whole journey. And tune in. I will be doing a special segment about the playoffs and the playoff matches. So please tune in. But until we meet again, everybody have a beautiful and blessed week. Thank you. And this is The Breakdown, X's and O's with Nate Nash. You guys all be blessed. Thank you.